Good evening, everyone, and welcome to session number 6 of our Falls Church City Public Schools Parent Summer University Learning Series. So we're very excited about our topic tonight. This is our 6th and final session for the summer, and I'm excited to have our presenters here tonight to talk to us about executive functioning in a school-age student. We have some amazing folks here to speak tonight, and I am going to turn the show over to them. For any of our parents who are here with us tonight, they're going to, our presenters will share the information, and then that usually lasts about 30, 35 minutes. And then the rest of the time we save for questions or any comments that parents have. And then we also monitor the chat if you'd like to leave us a note in the chat. At the end of the session is being recorded and broadcast on YouTube. At the end of the session, you'll be able to go onto our Parent University website and download the PowerPoint as well as any other resources that the presenters share with us this evening. So take it away.
So welcome. I am Brittany Allen Shaw. I am the special education administrator at Mary Ellen Henderson Middle School. You'll see we had 2 title slides because that first slide was kind of dry and boring and we like everything to be so fun. So that's why there are 2. And then I'll let Mr. Shake Shaft and Ms. Perrone introduce themselves as well.
Hi, I'll go. Kieran Shakeshaft, Mr. Shakeshaft, special ed teacher over at MEH.
Yes, and I'm Miriam Perrone. I work as a speech language therapist, both at Oak Street and Meridian.
So tonight we are going to talk about executive functioning, and Mr. Shakeshaft is going to get us started with a definition.
Hi. Okay. So we wanted to start with a definition because I feel like depending on who you ask, there's a lot of different ways to define executive functioning. It's a big buzzword right now. There's a lot of definitions going out there. This is one that we like. So executive function skills are the core set of cognitive skills required for planning, completing, and evaluating the completion of tasks. So those are the things that we're going to talk about today. And that's the definition that we've gone with. Okay. Also, along with the definition, the separate skills, if depending on who you ask, there's different names for all of them, but these are the ones that we're going to talk about specifically today. So we've got emotional control, self-monitoring, flexible thinking, working memory, task initiation, planning and time management, and then my favorite, organization.
So before we get started, there are a couple of key points that we want to really talk about and hit home for everyone to understand. So everyone has a pattern of strengths and weaknesses for all parts of their life, and executive functioning is no different. So some people may be very, very good at task initiation and perhaps not as good in the organization part. So we try to look at the different domains to pinpoint what are the areas that are strengths and what are the areas that may be a weakness that we really need to focus on and bring up. It is important to know that a weakness in executive functioning is not related to an intellectual ability. So you can be extremely smart and still have weaknesses in executive functioning. They do not go hand in hand, but they can impact how your student performs and their outputs. And executive functioning doesn't look the same for everyone. And we all kind of grow in our executive functioning skills at our own pace. And so it's essential to not kind of compare students to one another. Sure, there are certain, like they should be around this part, but we all grow in our own way. And executive functioning is no different. It does have to do with your brain, and your brain matures at varying paces. Next. So the first one that we really want to talk about, we kind of broke this into 4. These first 4 are.
And I can't get my earphones to work. Speaking of Brittany Allen Shaw.
Oh, hi, Ms. Friedlander. You're not muted.
Sorry, I can't find my stuff. Sorry.
So we broke this into kind of two sections. The first four that we're going to talk about are really kind of internal. And these are things that you may not see at the surface level with your student, but that are going on in their brain. So emotional control really has to do with how we manage our feelings, how we achieve our goals and complete tasks. This can show up as negative self-talk. So again, we don't see this, but your student could be presented with a task and in their head, they're telling themselves that they don't know how to do it and it's stopping them. And on the outside, we're like, why aren't you doing this? But it's all kind of an internal thing. Some things that we can do to help our student is to model positive self-talk, model how like, oh my goodness, I am frustrated right now. I'm not really sure what to do. Saying those things out loud and helping your student to see how we as adults process this is helpful for them to recognize that their concern is normal. Even as grownups, we still sometimes are like, I'm not sure what to do. As well as task matching. So we always want to make sure that we set our student up for success. I would never send my 7-year-old to go and make pancakes by herself, right? But I can send her to go get me a glass of water. She can be successful at that. We might find water on the floor, but she can be successful. So we want to make sure we give them tasks that they can accomplish. Next. And that same lens is self-control. And this is being able to stop before acting. This can show up as high levels of impulsivity or doing things before we fully evaluate the outcome. Full disclosure, this does not kind of fully graduate itself until mid-20s. So if your student is still really like, oh, it's pretty normal, actually. What you can do to help them, though, is to set limits. Showing them how we can control ourselves is helpful. And then preparing them in advance. So I know we all remember as kids when our moms would stop us before we go in the grocery store, we're not buying any candy, so do not ask. That was our parents kind of setting us up for success and reminding us of stopping before we act, before we get here, this is not what we're going to be able to do. So those things are actually very helpful in introducing self-control to our students. Self-monitoring, this is my kind of favorite because it ties so lovely into our IB reflection. And this is a huge skill and it's being able to kind of evaluate yourself and evaluate your ability. It may show up as either thinking too high or too little of oneself. So we all have had our students come back to us and say, this is done. And you're like, and in their head, it really is done. So helping them to understand what done looks like, what the outcome you're desiring is, praising when they do parts of it that are successful is very helpful. So, you know, if you are working on the routine of putting our clothes away, when they get them in the drawer, great. And then, you know, oh, you managed to put them all lined up. So really praising those things that they did right, as opposed to pointing out what wasn't correct, because that solidifies and encourages that behavior to continue. And then the last of the first four is flexible thinking. And so this is how we manage unexpected situations. So I thought we were going to go to the mall today, but it is pouring down raining. So that idea is gone. Understanding that your student may get stuck when they are given a task to do and things unexpectedly come up. So helping to talk to them about what do we do when it doesn't go right is very helpful. Having those rehearsal conversations of, well, what will we do if we don't have a pencil? How can we problem solve that? In the moment, sometimes our students can get stuck and they are unable to move forward. So practicing and rehearsing that strategy with them is helpful. It's also helpful for them to have a default strategy. So whenever you don't know what to do, what should you do? Should I go ask somebody? Should I take a break? What do I do with myself? But teaching them of that default is very helpful in flexible thinking, because even if they're stuck, they have something to resort back to.
Yeah, so just continuing on with what Brittany was saying, we really want to help our students, our children, kind of automate that positive self-talk for planning. So, for example, I'm teaching my daughter how to drive now, and her idea was to drive to Chipotle today, and she is not ready for the parking lot near Chipotle. So I said, okay, so our plan for today is to drive on residential streets in our familiar neighborhood. Our plan B, if it's pouring down rain, is to wait, and then we can drive twice tomorrow. So similarly, like with an academic assignment, many of our students, our children, really kind of struggle with writing assignments, and they kind of that even just seeing that there's a writing assignment is enough to begin this very negative self-talk. I suck at writing. I'm never going to finish. This is going to take forever. And what we want to try to do is replace that with, I'm going to finish doing my writing, and then I'm going to play Among Us. And if I start to get stuck on my writing, I'm going to go ask my cousin to scribe for me, because he's over here. He's at the kitchen table. He's doing homework too. He's older, and he'll help me. So that ties back too with what Brittany was saying about that default strategy. And so as kind of we model this for students, that really, really helps them. You know, whether we're modeling it as a teacher or as a parent, it helps them begin to kind of internalize that and be better at that skill themselves. And so, like, really thinking through, as Brittany was saying, about those contingencies, that can be so helpful for our students. And then something else to think about is modeling those future emotions when the task is completed. I'm going to be, you know, it could be about your own work. I'm going to be so relieved when this budget drill is done. You know, obviously your child, at least if they're similar to the ones that the teenagers and young adults in my house don't really care too much about the budget drill that you're responsible for, but that's still good to kind of model that. Or, you know, I can't wait till I'm finished folding this laundry so I can just put up my feet for a little while and watch Netflix. You know, whatever it is, kind of modeling that when you're finished something, you're most likely going to have a positive emotion associated with that. Modeling how the task is going to look when it's done, if we can just go back, Rebecca, for one more minute. Modeling how the task is going to look when it's done. So I'd like you to clean the bathroom. When it's done, all the surfaces are going to be wiped off. The tub is going to be scrubbed. You're going to have swept the floor and cleaned the floor and taken out the trash. That's helping them understand what really is it going to look like when it's done. And then lastly, and this is a really interesting one that I've kind of given a lot of thought to recently and want to focus on professionally this year, it's really helping our children and students learn when to ask for reassurance and when they need to request clarification and assistance. Because many times when someone is more anxious, they say, I need help, I don't understand. That's a good first step. But it might be really that they're just seeking reassurance. I need to know that I'm on the right track. I'm feeling a little uncomfortable right now. So helping them better understand whether what they need is reassurance or whether they really need clarification and assistance is useful.
So then that brings us to our second four, other half of those skills. These are the ones that you probably will see the most. These are the ones that you're like, oh my goodness, my kid is really struggling with this. So the first one is working memory. Working memory has to do with how we hold information in our memory in order to complete a task. So for example, when you say to your student, I need you to go upstairs and grab my phone, the remote, the cup, and the water, right? That's five steps that they need to remember. And what will happen is they'll remember step one and two. I'm going up the step and I'm grabbing the phone. And then they will come right back down and you're like, but where are the other ones? Because they really didn't keep that information. And so multi-step directions and assignments can be very challenging. So being able to provide your student with written reminders, rehearsing with them what we do in certain situations and creating consistent routines. I cannot stress how much a routine is so important when working memory is a deficit, because then you start to rely on muscle memory, right? So I know that every morning when I wake up, I have to brush my teeth, right? It's almost my body is on autopilot because I'm still half asleep, but I know I have to do that. That is the routine that my mom set for me when I was little, and I've carried that forth. And so creating routines and having reminders, I can remember the notes on the door that my mom would leave me. Did you put deodorant on? Did you brush your teeth? Did you put your homework in your book bag? Those helped me to make sure that I got all those steps done. And it is 110% age appropriate. Even all the way up through our high schoolers, they still need those reminders. We as adults still write our post-it note and stick it on the refrigerator. Those things are always kind of needed regardless of the age. Next.
Okay, that's me. Task initiation. This is, along with organization, probably one of my favorites as well. So task initiation, I'm sure, is one that you guys do see daily with your kids, but it's a fancy way of just talking about the ability to start and finish a task, often with, you know, what we're talking about, homework assignments, things like that, without procrastination. And how that will impact your child if they do have task initiation issues, it's difficulty beginning a given task. And this can manifest in different ways. This is kind of new. I know you guys have probably heard of flight or fight, but when we were talking about task initiation, we've kind of adopted flight, fight, and freeze. And this will look really, really different, right? Like for flight, that could literally mean that your child, when given an assignment, is like leaves the chair. That could happen, sure, depending on the age. But that could also mean that you give the kid, like a slightly older child, they have to write their paragraph and you turn your back and they're on the internet, right? They have left that assignment. They have not physically left the chair, but they've left the task. Or we're fighting, that's pretty self-explanatory, right? They will argue with you a lot of the time, will be resistant. And then freeze is when they literally, and I see this in the classroom all the time, is you will tell a kid, hey, we need to get started on this paragraph. You do a circulation, you come back in 5 minutes and they're still staring at the screen and nothing's happened. And that a lot of the time might happen because they're either overwhelmed, they're anxious, there's whole sorts of emotions that can cause that. But that is really common with kids that struggle with task initiation, is they freeze and they don't know what to do or how to get started. And it's not because they don't care, it's just a lot of the time the kids don't know how to get started.
One point that I want to push in right here, and Mr. Shake Shop alluded to this, is those first four that we talked about, the emotional control, flexibility, those four, those will inhibit your student when it comes to these next four, right? So that negative self-talk in their head is what could possibly be causing them to freeze or to fight or to flight from the assignment or whatever task it is. So all eight of these really do work together to help your student to be successful. And when, again, we have profiles of strengths and weaknesses. So when we have a weakness in one of those areas, it can then kind of trickle around because they all rely on each other.
And just sorry to interrupt, one other little thing, sorry, Mr. Shayshak, but I was thinking of a student I worked with years ago whose mom had shared this example. She had asked him to take the dog for a walk around the block. He was adopted and he had been with her for about a year. And he loved this dog, but he was like fighting her about it. And she was a social worker, like very skilled at interpersonal communication. And she finally figured it out. It took about 3 weeks, but he didn't know what around the block meant. He was a very literal thinker. And so he couldn't initiate the task, not because he was actually trying to be, you know, he actually wouldn't have minded taking the dog out, but because he didn't have that flexible thinking, he wasn't able to initiate the task. And once she was able to explain to him what it meant to take the dog for a walk around the block, there's no problem.
Awesome. And then the other one we're going to talk about is, or other two, there's one more after this, planning and time management, which I also love. So planning and time management is pretty self-explanatory, but it's the ability to set goals and meet them. So plan that you're going to do something and manage your time wisely so you complete what you're setting out to do. And a student that will struggle with planning and time management, how that will sort of manifest itself, is they're going to be struggling with deadlines and meeting set goals. So if you have a child that is consistently turning in assignments late, or has said that they're going to write one paragraph of their essay on Saturday and doesn't get it done. And these can also sort of filter in, as we talked about, into other areas, but that's how that will sort of manifest, a struggle with planning out when to do certain things. But there are a lot of tips and strategies to help with this one. Definitely calendars and schedules help a lot with planning and time management. I know that some parents that I've spoken to, one thing that they've tried that's been really helpful is setting a specific time in the day, every day, that is homework time for a set amount of time. So the kid knows at 4:30, it is homework time from 4:30 to 5 o'clock, and then it's dinner, hockey, whatever it is, right? So you have a set time, a routine, and a schedule, so they know and can plan that is the time to do work. Also, discussing time expectations with your child is really helpful too, and say, hey, like, you need to work for 30 minutes, or you have an assignment here, and based on what your teacher said, this is going to take about 30 minutes. So let's manage our time so we can get that done, and how much time that we think it will get done. And that's also builds into creating that time-based plan for completion. So it's really a lot of discussing with your child these routines, these schedules, and figuring out how to do things at a reasonable time so things can get done. And then my personal favorite is definitely organization. Which for a longest time I got organization and planning, like, oh, they're the same thing, but they're not, they're different. So organization is really the ability to develop and use systems, and we'll talk about what systems are, to keep track of materials and information. And as a middle school teacher, this is the one that I see the most often, I think, with kids a lot of the time, is you have your kids whose locker is very messy, backpacks very messy, homework binder is all over the place, that kind of disorganization. And that will manifest very easily as difficulty sort of keeping track of their writing utensils, like the most common one. I have so many kids who come to class, like, I don't know where I put my pencil, right? Or I don't know where this paper is, or they open up their backpack looking for a paper and there's like 50 loose leaf papers in there, right? Like, that lack of having a system to organize things. The biggest tip though, to give with working with a child that struggles with organization, is starting small. If you go to your child and say, hey, we're going to organize your locker, backpack, homework binder, regular binder, your room, all in 1 hour setting, it's not going to work. The kid will get overwhelmed, and the likelihood of them continuing it without constant supervision by you and intervention is not very likely. And the ultimate goal is that they are keeping themselves organized. And over time, you don't have to supervise as much. And that depends with the age, right? Like, we're not saying like a five-year-old is going to be completely independently organizing their stuff within a month, right? But starting small is important, especially with kids who struggle with organization a lot. And part of that process is creating that organization system and really allowing for reasonable student choice in that. I have a lot of parents who are like, well, I wrote things down in an agenda when I was in school, so my kid has to do that too. And it's like, well, there are some kids that do like to write things down. I'm a person who still writes things down. I've got post-its everywhere. That works for me, but that may not work for your kid. They may want to do things on, keep a note on their phone, keep a note on a Google Doc. There's all sorts of apps and software that exist nowadays for those organizational systems. So definitely work with your kid on finding one that you are comfortable with and they are comfortable with, because if they're not comfortable with it, they're not going to use it.
And then one last small point too is making sure that you focus on what actually counts, right? A lot of time, I think we make organization systems too grand with parts that don't matter. So if your real focus is, I want you to bring all of your homework home, so then our only focus is going to be putting every piece of homework in this homework folder and bringing it home. Two steps. That's it, right? Later, once we've mastered that, then we can add a next step. But a huge problem that I see often, myself included, is starting too big and having 10 steps. And we think it's reasonable. And our student struggles, and then everyone is frustrated. So we always want to make sure that we are starting in a way that we are setting our student up for success. And so giving them two steps or even one step, here's your homework folder, put in your book bag every day, right? Maybe you got all the homework, maybe it didn't, but you want them to be successful so that they have that encouragement and will want to build on it.
Yeah, so what we're gonna talk about next is something called Get Ready, Do Done, which is a flexible framework that you can use for supporting executive functioning. And the idea behind it is very simple. It's that whenever we have an activity or an assignment, it could be learning how to take your violin out of the box, whatever it is. There's really three questions we should be asking. And you start with, what does done look like? So what does it look like when I'm going to be done? And then what steps do I need? And what materials will I need? So in some ways it's counterintuitive, but especially for our students and children who have executive functioning weaknesses, there's some research that documents that they do not have, their visualization skills are not as strong. And so if you can help someone picture what it looks like when they're going to be finished, it's easier to engage them with the task. And then the Rebecca, if you want to, perfect. So here's like a flow chart kind of showing what it looks like. So you start with the red, like what will my assignment look like when it's done? Now this is more academic, but as I said before, it really could be with any activity or task. Then what steps do I need to do? Then what materials do I need? Then you get the materials, then you get started, then you complete the task, and then you reflect on the task. So circling back to what we were talking about earlier in the presentation about evaluating how the assignment went, evaluating how the activity was, and really building that in as you go. We've used this some in classrooms, used it some with individual students. It has been really helpful for some students. Like I'm thinking in particular about a younger elementary age student who was really struggling with the routine of coming in the morning. And, the teacher had provided a lot of explicit instruction, but it wasn't until the other speech therapist that I work with, she went in and did a get ready, do done with the student. And then within a couple of days, he was able to complete his morning routine independently. And that is like that's so powerful because we want our students to be independent as possible. It's so much better for a student to be able to be successful and not relying on an adult to verbally prompt them through everything. It's something that if you're willing to try it at home, even just with, could be something like, a chore or, and actually I would encourage, like when I introduce it to students, oftentimes we'll do something fun. Like I love cooking. So, we'll let's make an ice cream sundae. So what does it look like when I'm done? What are the steps I need to do? What are the materials I need? And then we go through and do it. So, for our older students, for our high school students, there's a different process of getting buy-in for trying something like this. But for some of our students that are younger, it's I find that students are pretty willing to try. And then just here are some examples. This is one from someone from here in FCCPS who was staff who was struggling with his daughter cleaning up her room. I think she's five or so. So not super small, but still young. And so they made up this get ready, do done together. And then afterwards she was really kind of successful with it. So an example of using it at home with a younger child. And then the next example that we have, this is actually, I apologize, it's a little blurry, but this is for an OT task, an occupational therapy task. They were making sensory bottles. And you can see under the done, there's actually like a reflection component I made, and then the student has to kind of circle what they made and what color it was, and then reflect on whether they thought it was fun or boring or okay. And then this is for something I made for fifth grade students. They have an explorer project that is actually very layered. And I was thinking what Brittany was saying about keep it simple. And this may not be the best example of keeping it simple, but a complex project, they had to have a model, a 3D model, a paragraph, a 3 to 5 minute oral presentation. But having it, and the fifth grade team does an excellent job at really breaking this project up and has a very good organizer for it. But having like a one sheet was helpful really, I think, for some of my students, because they could kind of see, okay, there's, you know, three things that I really am going to have to do: a model, paragraph, and then this presentation. And then that second broke down all the steps. And then if you look under Get Ready, one of the things that we talk about with our students too, is you need to be open-minded. You need to be a communicator. So it's when we think about what materials we need, sometimes they're not, it's not a pencil, it's not a laptop, it's actually a flexible mindset. That's really important, especially depending on the student.
And that Get Ready, Do Done can be scaffolded up or down. So mm-hmm. that last example had like three done things. Mm-hmm. You could very easily do a Get Ready, Do Done for each part of the project as well.
And that's actually, I can't remember whether I did that or not, but I talked with the SPED teacher about that, because it is oftentimes helpful to have sort of, they're labor intensive to make, but like having several that can help with seeing, like for a large project like that, the entirety of it, and then also kind of the breakdown for the individual components is really helpful.
And so here we have a visual. These have some slightly different words. So I just wanted kind of parents to be able to see that some of these are interchangeable. And then next up, Mr. Shakeshaf is going to talk about our ATOM project. This year, Mary Ellen Henderson Middle School did win the 2022 Community Health Improvement Award from Children's National Hospital due to a connection that a pilot program that we worked with them on. Mr. Shakeshaf is going to kind of tell us some more. And while this program, we will pilot it again this year, it is still in its research phases. So they are primarily working with students who have documented executive functioning deficits. And sadly, this program is middle school specific. So it's not an elementary version, and there's not a high school version. But we found that there were many key components that the program had that can be duplicated outside of the program. So we still wanted to share kind of the big takeaways that we had this year after working kind of intensively on executive functioning skills. So Shakeshaf?
Sure, we go to that next slide, Ms. Sharp. Awesome, okay, so all about ATOM. So yes, it is geared to middle school kids, but as Ms. Allen Shaw said, there are some really awesome takeaways that can be used for any age student who is struggling with sort of these executive functioning skills. The two though that ATOM focuses on primarily is organization and planning and time management. And how they do this is really intuitive. And I found it to be really successful with the kids is through an individualized reward-based system. So essentially what that would mean is the kid would complete organizational checklists, right? They would check their backpack and be like, okay, good. No loose paper, no loose pencils. They go through their binder and they'd be, okay, I have dividers. All my papers are in the right place. Check, 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 whatever. And then they get coins for completing those checklists. And later on in the program, we add a little bit more things, right? Because as we talk about, you start small and then you slowly build and build and build and build. And then eventually we were doing things for getting coins for putting in assignments into a digital agenda and planning out what homework to do during homework time at home and when that homework time would be. And then those kids who accumulate these coins would then use them to purchase rewards in a store that was in class. And eventually with the program, it was pushed out of the classroom and me facilitating to parents doing it. So the goal of ATOM is over time, it's done at home between parents and student, with it just being taught at school. But we can go to the next slide because there are some major takeaways that I think are applicable to everybody. So the biggest thing with Adam, and this is something that when I talk to parents who were involved in the study, that we would discuss this a lot, because at first there can be a little bit of resistance. Like, why do I need to reward my kid for organizing things? Isn't this something that they should just do without a reward? And Adam's whole philosophy, which I think works, and it worked really well with the kids, it makes perfect sense to me, is that a lot of these kids who struggle with organization need to feel success in their organization before they can get that intrinsic motivation, right? So they need to look at their homework and say, oh, wow, this is really organized. I've turned in my things on time. My grades are going up, or my writing's getting better. My backpack's looking better, whatever it is. And then eventually the idea and the hope is that they take that success and it becomes like, I like this feeling of success. So I'm going to continue to do these positive things without necessarily maybe candy or a trip to the Lego store or whatever it is that the reward is. I mean, that does take time. Every kid is different. For some kids, it's quicker that you get there. Some kids, it's a long road. But the philosophy is that it works. And I do believe in that. The second thing is definitely planning out homework time. And I talked about this a little bit, like setting a specific time during the day. And I'd say with certain kids, once they have that down, what Adam does, which is really cool, is push kids to plan out specifically what they're going to do during that homework time. Because I think that you'll get a lot of kids that now get in the habit of, yeah, okay, 4:30, I do homework. But the next question is, what do I prioritize? Which homework is the most important to do first? Is the daily math assignment more important than the summative essay due tomorrow? That's something eventually that kids will have to grapple with and plan out. So really working with your child on, once they have a set time, on how to prioritize and what specifically they'll do. Like today from 4:30 to 5, I'm going to start with math 1.1, and then I'm going to write the topic sentence for my essay, right? So breaking it down specifically into tasks. And then the last big takeaway is definitely checklists. I think this helps a lot with kids who are struggling with different facets of organization, right? Whether it be a binder, backpack, room, whatever, making checklists of what exactly do they need to do to make that room clean. And this feeds into sort of the other things that we've been talking about, right? Is that if you want a child's backpack to be clean, you need to break down exactly what that means and check off as you go and check and do those things. But those are definitely the three big takeaways.
So then kind of to close us out, we did throw out a couple of resources. So this first one is the book Smart But Scattered, the Revolutionary Executive Skills Approach to Helping Kids Reach Their Potential. I have found this book to be extremely helpful. That it does have checklists in it. It helped me to ground my expectations in age appropriateness, as well as giving strategies of how we can increase areas of weakness. The next one is an executive functioning skills development by age chart. And I think that this is going to be so helpful for parents, also super helpful for us, and really kind of lowering our expectations to a reasonable place. I have a 7-year-old, and at one point I honestly believed that she should be able to take her shower, get her lotion on, get dressed, and be at the table ready to go to school by herself. What? So we have definitely scaled that back to some realistic expectations, and our success rate has gone through the roof. And then the last thing is actually an app, and I believe it's pronounced Breely. It's a routine app where parents can kind of help their student establish a routine. It has a visual timer. It has reminders. There is an adult version as well, if parents need some help here too. And what I like most about it is that you can monitor your student's success or progress through their routine from your device. So it kind of gives them this feeling of independence, that they are chugging their way and you can still see, like, okay, you're on task 3. Are you actually doing that? And it helps kind of keep things moving. It has little chimes as the timer kind of moves on at the halfway point, at the 2-minute mark, and then at the 30-second mark. It does have rewards. You can add in your own rewards to help kind of extrinsically motivate your student. And it really kind of digitizes all of the things. They have some preset templates for morning routines, afternoon and night chores. So I think I want to stress, do not kind of sleep on technology. Technology is so helpful right now in helping to build those executive functioning skills in our students. So that kind of wraps us up. So I guess we open the floor for comments or questions.
Jump that one. Well, since everyone's quiet, I do have a question. Thank you for the great presentation. My question is, can you recommend some strategies to help us move our kids from being extrinsically motivated to intrinsically motivated? That's a hard jump sometimes, I think, for kids. And is it always necessary? Because I feel like as adults, you know, I'm a 53-year-old woman. I'm still extrinsically motivated. I like my paycheck. I love my house. And I love when I work hard, get my paycheck, and I can go get my nails done, or I can buy that Kate Spade purse. How do we help parents understand that? And then how do we help kids be more intrinsic?
Well, Ms. Sharp, that is, whew.
Sorry, I didn't mean to ask such a hard question.
So I think it's helpful when, so one of the things that we said is really to offer praise of your student, like, you did such a great job, but also reframing that into, are you proud of yourself? How do you feel by doing this? How did that make you feel to accomplish that task? And really helping them to increase that personal ownership of it and that personal pride in what they've done. And then also, like, in real life, we're still intrinsically motivated. So being able to kind of move away from rewards to reality, I think, is a more reasonable expectation, helping your student to see the connection between cause and effect. When I do my homework at 4:30, I now have the rest of my day to watch TV and eat snacks. And so helping them to make those connections is, I think, one of the ways you can move them into intrinsic motivation, because they start to see how doing this benefits me.
Yeah, I was just going to tag on to that. I think sometimes I do this behavior mapping with students, and you can use it as behavior. I don't necessarily mean that behavior could be negative, positive, neutral, like saying waving hi, I think of as can be a behavior, but you help them connect that to what the outcomes are, and then to how they feel about it and how other people feel. Mm-hmm. So I think that sort of can help drive like intrinsic motivation. So like kind of similar to what Brittany was saying, like, okay, so you finished your homework. So the outcome of that was that you had extra time to play Mario Kart or to do D&D, whatever it is. you seemed like you just had like such a blast. I could hear you from the next room laughing or whatever it is. And then that made me feel really proud of you, that you finished your work and that you had time just to relax, because we all need time to relax.
Agreed. One of the app that we kind of put up earlier, it creates routines and it has time limits. But if you move through your routine at the end, all your extra time is like reward time. And so when we first introduced this with my daughter, the first night she was like, this is awful. There's so many things. And I was like, but Rye, if you finish, then you have free time. And so the first night, I think she maybe got 5 minutes of free time. At this point, she's at a place where she can get 30 minutes of free time if she moves her way through her routine. And I'm finding now I have to give her less and less reminders, because she wants to be able to be done. She's proud of herself. Mommy, I did all of my things and now I'm gonna go watch YouTube. But, you know, so I know at some point I need to go back and like redo her routine, right? Like, once our kids start showing success and they've mastered that, then that's when we build on it, right? So her first routine had a lot of space. She has 17 minutes to take a shower. Please pray for my water bill. Now she takes her shower in 5 minutes, right? Like before it was a lot, I don't know what she was in there doing. But these things are how you kind of, the routines really help to bring it internal. Other questions? Yay.
And thank you, Ms. Friedlander, Ms. LaGuardia Myers. Thank you so much for your comments. Yes. So I know our presenters can't see those because they're presenting, but it was thanking them for the actionable takeaways that you can use at home, that parents can use at home. Ms. Wolf is asking, what strategies do you recommend for smaller assignments, such as a math worksheet assigned on Monday, but it's due on Friday? Our student will delay and delay and delay on getting it done because of the longer there is time to get it done.
Kieran, Mr. Shakeshaft, you want to tag in first?
Sure. So I think my first thought with something like that, right, is to try and, I would talk to the student and figure out why is it that they are procrastinating in that first place, right? Like even if technically, right, if it's due Friday, you can do it Thursday and it still be on time, right? Like that's fine. But there's definitely when I'm working with kids, I'm always trying to figure out the why of why they do things, right? So in this case, why, even if it is an easy assignment, why are they procrastinating all the way until the end, right? And figuring out really what executive functioning issue that could be, right? Because it could be a bunch of different ones. And once you know that from talking to your kid about why that is happening, that's when you can pick your specific strategy to really target and work with the student on what to do. Because it really depends on, like, are they procrastinating because they're overwhelmed? Are they procrastinating because they're not managing their time and don't have a set time that they want to do it? Are they not sure how to do it because they're or disorganized with the materials that they need, right? It totally depends. So definitely start there.
For a lot of our students, it's usually the scope and scale of things that shuts them down. Like, I mean, I know it's just one page, but there are 25 problems on here and I just don't want to do it. And so I find that helping our students to see that if you just do a little bit at a time, it goes by so much faster. And so where I would start out with that is setting a timer. I want you to work on this worksheet for 6 minutes. Whatever you get done in 6 minutes, we're done with it. And parents, you have to be done at 6 minutes, okay? You gotta hold on to your end of the deal or else they won't trust you next time. And then at the end of the week, showing him that, see how easy this was when we just did 6 minutes a day versus doing 45 minutes in one night and how stressful that is. So we actually started this with my daughter's bedroom because her room. And I kept saying to her, right, if you just clean it up a little bit every night, it stays clean. And she fought and fought and fought. It ended up in her routine, right? Like Mr. Shakeshaft said, setting a homework time. We are going to do homework for 30 minutes every day. Even if you have nothing to do, then we're just going to read a book and answer questions. But being consistent and concrete with that will help with those small assignments because they know, like, I got to spend 30 minutes doing this anyway. So I might as well spend a little bit of time here, a little bit of time tomorrow, and that will help them kind of move along through the process. But as you go, facilitating that conversation of making the connection. Don't you see that when we did this a little bit at a time, it was so much easier than doing it all at once because they're not going to make that connection independently at this age.
And I guess I would say I'd be curious if they finish the work. They just don't do it like in a manner, like if they have it ready, if it's all done and ready to go for Friday, but they just stay up later on Thursday night than you want. And then that interrupts when you'd like them to be in bed, you know, because I do think that, you know, within this, sometimes there's just, you know, we all have different ways of approaching tasks. Some of us are more, I would include myself, need a little bit more of a deadline to get going. If it's disruptive, then it seems like it would be really worthwhile, like trying these different strategies. But if your child gets it done, but just doesn't do it kind of in the way that you or other family members would do it, then I wouldn't necessarily think it's something that would, you know, that you'd need to focus too much on, but certainly if it's disruptive, that would make sense to try all these strategies.
No, this is all very helpful. And I think it is also considering, yes, our student does things a little differently than we might do it. So that's always helpful to consider. And I also think that I like the idea of for these shorter, longer term assignments, because I know we're entering middle school next year and the classes will meet every other day. So it's planning, you actually have that extra day when something's due. So I like that concept of really finding that time that we consistently use daily. Mm-hmm. And then also the timer, I think, is a good idea too. And then to look, kind of reevaluate at the end of the week, you know, what worked, what didn't work, and take it from there. I think that's all. This has all been very helpful.
So one big tip that we tell parents, I can't remember if we had our rising sixth grade transition night, is do your homework for the classes you had that day. The kids will be like, it's not due until Wednesday, so I'm gonna do it tomorrow. No, do it today. So that way, if you have questions or you didn't understand something, you have tomorrow to go ask. And if you don't, then you're free tomorrow, right? So I would highly encourage you, as you're building your rise to middle school routine, do your homework, prioritize the homework for that day first. Then if your timer ended and I didn't finish something from yesterday, then we start there. But that day's homework.
Yeah, and just thinking about like that balance too, right? Like if you're more efficient with your work, like you have more time to do other things. And so kind of reinforcing that message in different ways, I think is really helpful for kind of buy-in and changing habits.
Mm-hmm. Well, thank you to everyone for joining us this evening. Thank you to our amazing presenters. You guys were so wonderful, and we all appreciate you giving up a night on your summer to come and be with us and share this great information. I think we have one more piece that thank you, and Ms. Wolf says thank you in the chat as well. So I didn't want to miss anything in there. So this has been a great session, and I hope everyone goes and has an enjoyable night and stays dry despite all the rain, and that you keep your power. So have a great evening.
Good night, everyone.